A blessed good night to all as we come here to celebrate the new year, as we exit the old year and we go into the new year. We wish to celebrate that new season. It's a new season. It's a new day. A fresh anointing is coming our way. It's a season of power and prosperity. It's a new season coming to me. The year began with some powerful seasonings. It's a new season, we were told. Time for a new flavoring. Flavorings that would dominate. Flavorings that would stimulate. Commanding flavors that didn't only wet the palate, but flavors that would control how all of we operate. Flavors that would prevail long after you get the first taste. Potent flavors with influence so great. They left the taste buds asking for more upon the plate. And as the year started, so it continued with these dominating flavorings for me and for you. We went through enough seasons for the year, so much so that we all should be experts at them by now, you hear? We started this with seasonings of peace, power, prosperity, and prayer, filled with things that the Father wanted to say. We knew from the get-go that things were going to get real tasty up in here this year. We had a season for giving all. Wholehearted service was the call. Even if we walked through the wilderness, to be like Caleb and respond with readiness was the first step to passing this test. Report reliably, remain resolute, never becoming discouraged, regardless of what circumstances confronted we. Stand firm for God's cause, and by so doing, just like Caleb, we will receive our just reward by walking closely with the Lord. We were flavored with a season of reconciliation and restoration, reminded that our God, though not guilty of any wrongdoing, did not see himself too big to reconcile man unto him. He took the first step, all in line with his perfect plan, and gave his only son as reconciliation for fallen man. After sin's destructive separation, which led to alienation from him, the sacrificial death of his son was the only means to restoration. And so came this flavor, humble pie to swallow. Our fault or not, take the first step to mend any broken relationship. Moving forward together, no one left behind, because after all, we as brother and sister, and we need to live as one. Sometimes, hallelujah, sometimes, praise the Lord, sometimes, gently singing, our hearts in one accord. We got seasoned with rebirth, a time for renewal. Then it was refilled, where God restock and replenish, so much so that we overflowed with God's grace and all he had to offer us. And in return, he asked us to overflow with praise. Then he reminded us that though broken, he could reuse us again and again, because after all, he's the potter and we are the clay. He's molding us in his own way. Free yourself, he said. Self-limiting thoughts will not do if we are to fulfill what God has called us to do. So time to say no to lies, deception, feelings of worthlessness and incapability, forbidding the enemy of our souls to hold us captive when God has made us free and given us power and authority. time for closure in those areas of our life that need it. Forgiveness. Let go of grudges, pain of the past. Let go of the mistakes so we can move on. Remember, trials help build perseverance and character in us. Leave negativity behind for 2024. Hatred, heartbreak, temper, jealousy, throw all of them out the door. So with all this good, well-seasoned food and long-lasting favorings to drive us, where are you? Where are we at the end of 2023? Are we where God wants us to be? So seasons come and seasons go. We all know. Sometimes they change even before you even know. Before you even realize it, we are on to the next with such subtlety. We don't realize it, but this is reality. And as each season change, preparation for the season is a must. We have seen the beauty of 2023. It was a season of preparation. It has prepared us for the challenge of 2024. This must be a season of action. The lessons learned should allow us to rise victoriously, conquering the enemy, not letting the devil have any victory. So start fulfilling your God-given purpose now and walk into 2024 with a new mindset, the right attitude. This must be a season of excellence, and hence, that must be our pursuit. I now invite the worship team to come forward and lead us in worship. After that, it will be followed by special ministry by Sister Naomi Williams and Sister Judy Bellamy. And then we'll have another worship set, followed then by prayer. Joy is here, amen. May it add a season of joy for all of us. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Amen, amen, amen.
Amen.
A season of joy, hallelujah. Trinity, my sorrows.
continue praising. And this is a season this night. This is a season for praising God. We praise him in the good times. We praise him in the bad times. We praise him all throughout 2023. And we will go into 2024 praising God, because he is good.
Sing praises.
Sing praises
unto God. Sing praises.
Hallelujah.
reflection. Another year is almost gone. How would we give account of all the things we did each day? To what would they amount? How many days were spent in prayer and thanks to God above for all the good things he bestowed and his abounding love? Did we stop to smell the roses and enjoy the refreshing breeze? Or did we murmur and complain every time we felt a sneeze? Did we interact with our neighbors and spread some love and care? Or did we hope that when we stepped outside, somehow they wouldn't be there? Did we share the gifts we have with those who are in need? Or were we mean and selfish and somehow filled with greed? How did we share the goodness of Christ the Savior's love and show them that there's hope and peace which comes from God above? Christmas celebration is over, and Christmas celebration is over, and we've somehow forgotten the reason that Christ came to this sinful world. It wasn't just for a season. He came that we might have new life, and that abundantly. He gave his life on Calvary's cross that we from sin be set free. So, as the new year begins to dawn and we look forward with glee, don't forget that Jesus came to give life eternally. So spread the word why Jesus came. Tell all about his love. So when this life on earth is past, we'll live with him above.
Lord, when you placed your hands upon me, I knew that I would never be the same. For in that moment I became your servant, and since that day I only have one aim. My soul desire is to be used, an empty vessel longing to be filled by you. My soul is to serve you, Lord, to do your perfect will, to work each day and build your kingdom. This is my soul desire. Lord, I do not seek to claim the glory. I only wish to be under your control. For I know that you alone are worthy, and it's you who place this longing my soul. My soul desire is to be used, an empty vessel longing to be filled by you. My soul desire is to serve to will, to work each day and build your kingdom. This is my soul's is to serve you, Lord, to do your perfect will, to work each day and build your kingdom. This is my soul's desire. Jesus, this is my soul's desire.
God is good.
All the time.
And all the time.
God is good.
Let us say it with conviction. God is good.
God is good.
All the time.
All the time.
Let's say it one more time. God is good.
God is good.
All the time.
All the time.
All the time.
All the time.
God is good.
God is good.
Let me tell you why God is good. He is a good shepherd.
Yes. Hallelujah.
He is a good shepherd.
Amen.
He leads us. He leads us. He restores us. He takes us into the path of righteousness. He comforts us and he protects us. Have you ever heard of someone who has done all of those things for you? We have a risen Savior. He came into this world. He died for our sins. And he lives within our hearts. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Over.
our heart.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Anybody here can testify to the goodness of God during 2023?
Amen.
Anybody here has something to give God thanks for? Has God been good to anybody this evening? Can you testify to his goodness this evening? Hallelujah. We lift your name up this evening, God. We give you thanks for your goodness towards us. Only because of your mercy and your love, God, that we are here. We give you thanks. Hallelujah.
I love you, Lord, for your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God.
You are tonight joining us online. We want you in your living room, in your dining room, in your bedroom, wherever you are, to just pause for a moment as we call upon the name of our faithful God, who has brought us through a year that has been a tough year, but has brought us right to the end of this year and to the brink of the next. And we lift our hands, we lift our voices and saying, yes, Lord, you are a good God. You are a faithful God. And tonight we remember the words of the psalmist who said that we should enter his gates with thanksgiving and we should enter his courts with praise and be thankful unto him and bless his name, because the Lord is good and his faithfulness endures to all generations. Father, tonight, we bless you. We honor you tonight. We agree with the psalmist who said that from the rising of the sun, even until the going down of the same, the name of the Lord is to be praised. And so we praise you, God. Father, in spite of where we are tonight, in spite of how we are feeling tonight, in spite of the season that we are experiencing tonight, we bless your name. We take the posture of the psalmist who said, I will bless the Lord at all times, and his praise shall continually be in my mouth. So, Father, for those who are on the mountaintop, God, we bless you. But even for those who are going through valley experiences, thank you, because your word says that even when we pass through life's valleys, you are with us. And so we still bless you and honor you tonight. Father, thank you for the journey. Thank you for the triumphs and the victories. Thank you, Lord, for the low moments, the moments of defeat, that we're able to build character in us. And Father, through the multitude of these experiences, we are glad that you've developed us into the people that we are. And we say, praise the name of the Lord. Praise the name of the Lord. We pray for those who are joining us tonight and who are going through tough times, difficult times, challenging experiences. Father, I pray that you would reach down right now and that you will minister into each heart. You will minister into each home in the name of Jesus. I'm praying, God, that where there is lack, Father, that you will replenish. I'm praying, God, that where there is sickness, that you will sprinkle, God, of your healing power in the name of Jesus. I'm praying, Father, for those who are feeling weak tonight, Lord, that you would remind them that your word says that when we are weak, then we are strong, because your strength is made perfect in our weakness. Father, those who are losing hope, who are living in despair, I pray, God, that you would lift their heads up and remind them that you are God and above you there is no other. So Father, we look to you tonight, asking for strength, asking for guidance, asking for direction, asking for insight. Even as we come to the brink of a new year, we don't know what it holds, God. But Father, we are going to hold on to you because you can lead us through this year. And so Father, we pray for our nation, Barbados. We pray, Father, that from the top, from the head, Lord, that you will speak into their lives. Father, across the spectrum of our leadership, I pray, God, that you will speak into the lives of our leaders, our secular leaders, our church leaders, Lord, our community leaders, wherever they are. May we lead your people correctly, according to your will and according to your ways. May we, Lord, practice what we preach. And I pray, God, that our nation will prosper. I pray, God, that churches would be in good health and would make a difference in this nation and, Father, right across our world. So we bless you, Lord. We believe you, Lord God, that you're going to take us through this year. And we're going to come out at the end victorious because you are with us. So, Father, we bless you and we give you thanks and we give you honor and we give you glory. In the name of your Son, Christ Jesus, we have prayed. And all God's people said, amen, amen, amen.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to our Father. Tonight, we want to welcome you to our All Year's Night service. We're here at the Silver Sands Church of God. As we gather to ring out the All Year and ring in the new, we want to invite you into our space. And we hope that you're going to be blessed by whatever is going to be done here tonight. Wherever you are, whether you are in Barbados, whether you are in some other part of the world, wherever you are in your living rooms, we want to thank you for joining us tonight. And as we always say, as our pastor always say, we don't steal sheep, we just plant grass. And you know, if you're going to be looking for a church that you want to attend in 2024, Silver Sands Church of God, we have wide open doors. And we will welcome you anytime that you wish to come. Tonight, our theme is Fork in the Road. What choices, what decisions did you have to make in 2023? What decisions will you have to make in 2024, what are those decisions that you are going to be faced with that are going to make a major difference in your life? Tonight, that is what we want you to reflect on. Where are you going from here? Are those decisions that you make going to put you in a better stead, or are they going to leave you behind? Those are the things that we want you to reflect on tonight. At this time, I'm going to invite Sister Nayo Braunton, who's going to come, and she's going to be doing special ministry for us in song. Sister Nayo.
Thank you. victory or defeat, it's up to me to decide. But how can I expect to win if I never try? I just can't give up now. I've come too far from where I started from. Nobody told me the road would be easy, and I don't believe he's brought me this far to meet me. Never said there wouldn't be trials, never said I wouldn't fall, never said that everything would go the way I want it to go. But when my back is against the wall and I feel all hope is gone, I'll just lift my head up to the sky and say, help me to be strong. Whoa. I just can't give up now. I've come too far from where I started from. Nobody told me the road would be easy, and I don't believe he's brought me this far to meet me. No, you did.
Just can't give up now. God did not bring us this far to leave us. He promised that through the trials and through the tests, through the tribulations, that he is going to be there. That was his promise. And God's promises are indeed true. As you move in to 2024, don't give up. Don't give up. God promises to walk with you. We are now going to hear from our speaker for the night, Minister Bellamy, our assistant pastor, is going to come to speak to us on the topic, the fork in the road. As he comes, I want you to welcome him. I hope that you're going to listen to what he has to say. I'm very curious to learn about this fork in the road and the choices and decisions that we will have to make. Minister Bellamy.
There is something almost mercurial about standing at the end of a year and looking over into a new year. God is good, and God has been good. There's something mighty sweet about the Lord God whom we serve. Tell you, bow your heads with me in prayer. Father, we open our hearts to you this evening, thanking you for your goodness, thanking you for your mercy and your compassion, thanking you for bringing us to the end of this year 2023. We have experienced your goodness, Lord. We have experienced your compassion and your mercy. And we are filled with confidence, Lord God, that you who have brought us through 2023 will take us into 2024 and you will be with us. For you have promised never to leave us nor forsake us. And so we thank you for this privilege of being able, God, Lord, to look into your word, to benefit from your word that you have given to us. I pray, God, Lord, even now that the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart, God, would be acceptable unto you, Lord God. Bless your people. Pray these things in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen and amen. Hallelujah. An idiom in any language is a group of words, their connotation, or their real meaning not readily understood or extractable from the way in which they are presented. In other words, as it relates to an idiom, it is not a straightforward matter to look at a set of words grouped together and easily determine what that group of words mean. I wish this evening to elucidate this point by taking a quick look at some of the more popular idioms that are within our sphere. Take, for instance, a blessing in disguise. So we think about a blessing in disguise and we wonder what a blessing in disguise is. It's a good thing that initially seemed to have been bad. We think about adding insult to injury and we wonder when we think about this group of words with what really we are confronted. So it means to act in a way that makes a bad situation even worse. So take, for example, you're getting a ride to school in a wheelbarrow, which perhaps is filled with ignominy. And then to make matters worse, you are dumped on the pavement. We consider that adding insult to injury. Then we think about actions that speak louder than words. And so we ask ourselves the question, really, what this idiom means, that action speaks louder than words. And this refers to the idea that it is better to do something than just talk about it, for actions speak louder than words. So there were some popular idioms that we have within our language. But this evening, our idiom for this last day of the year 2023 is a fork in the road. Our idiom for this last day of 2023 is a fork in the road. Anybody here tonight want to decipher the meaning of this popular idiom? Well, let me spend a moment this evening to bring some clarity to this idiom. Literally speaking, fork in the road is the point at which one road splits or separates into other roads. But idiomatically speaking, fork in the road symbolizes the point at which one is called upon to make a decision between two or sometimes more drastically different choices, options that can lead to quite distinctly different outcomes. Fork in the road. Fork in the road symbolizes a critical juncture in life or a critical juncture in perhaps a life or a death situation that we are faced with. Fork in the road represents a turning point in a moment of decision which can redound to being a critical moment in time. Fork in the road. I want to suggest to somebody this evening that the idiom fork in the road places an emphasis on the importance of decision-making moments that are likely to shape our path and shape our future. So whether it's in your personal lives or whether it's in your social circles or whether it is in our professional arena, the fork in the road challenges us to think and to choose. The fork in the road challenges us to action that oftentimes lead to significant change and development. Fork in the road. Without a doubt, and saints of God, and to my mind, the last day of the year, the last day of any year, represents a fork in the road. In a few moments from now, when the hands of the clock reaches the midnight hour, there will be a signal that the year 2023 has come to an end. And as the second hand of the clock moves past the midnight hour, the year 2024 would have begun. Did I hear somebody say, "Thank you, Lord"? Yeah, thank you, Lord, for one more year. Thank you, Lord, for watching over us. Thank you, Lord, that our trials and tribulations have made us victorious. We praise your name, Lord God, most great and glorious. Thank you, Lord, for one more year. Hallelujah. For some, it has been a year that was filled with challenges. A year 2023 that might have been filled with challenges would have come to an end. But for all of us, saints of God, a year that holds not what we know would have begun in a few minutes from now. And of one thing we can sing in chorus this evening is, "Hitherto hath the Lord helped us." Amen. As Christians, we can all sing in chorus, "We have come this far by faith." Leaning on the Lord and trusting in his holy word. As Christians, we can all sing in chorus, "If it had not been for the Lord on our side, where would we be?" As Christians, we can shout, "You, God, has been our refuge and our strength, of every present help in times of trouble." Amen, and glory to the God of heaven and earth. And from me, here is an encouragement as we look toward to a year that is coming that we know not what it holds. Keep trusting in Almighty God. Hold on and never let go. be strong and be of good courage. Like the songwriter, I say this evening, when troubles are in your life, sing praises. When troubles in your life, sing praises unto God. For God is our King over all the earth. He is our King over all the earth. So clap your hands and shout, all ye people, for the God whom we serve is worthy to be praised. Fork in the road. Fork in the road. Have you ever found yourself at a junction where there was not only one choice of two ways to go, but a choice of many more than two ways? Perhaps this evening you can think of a junction such as a turnpike located in the parish of St. George, but with a few more options. Did I hear somebody say this evening that we can think about six roads in the parish of St. Philip as well? Have you ever, saints of God, ever been at a junction where you sat there peering intently at the road signs and trying desperately to be directed as if by some magic wand which way to go? I have been in such a predicament. Somebody once offered this fact. And he says that when you are far out in the country and what we Bajans call places behind God's back, places located, say, perhaps in the parish of St. Lucy and St. Peter, and you get lost and you do not know how to get back home, somebody offered a simple explanation and a simple solution: to follow the bus stops that say bus to town. Everybody knows where we're from town. Perhaps back then you might have been at a junction where you knew where you were going, but because of the options that were presented to you, you stood there and did not know which option to take because there were so many options. I have been there in such a predicament. But I want to remind somebody this evening, a timely reminder from the Word of God that is found in the book of Deuteronomy chapter 30 and verse 19. The writer says to us, this day I call the heavens and the earth as witnesses against you, that I have set before you life and death, blessings and cursings. Now choose life, so that you and your children may live. As we examine this verse of scripture found in the 30th chapter of Deuteronomy, there can be no doubt within our minds that God has placed two choices before us. He says he has set before us two ways, life and death, blessings and curses. And he has suggested to us that we should choose life. Perhaps here's a timely reminder from the Word that God says broad is the way that leads to destruction, and many are there that enter thereby. But he says narrow is the gate that leads to life eternal, and few there be that follow this path. Choices. So we are fast approaching this year 2023. I want to say to you this evening that when you come to the fork in the road, when you come to the end of this year 2023, when you come to that fork, I want you to be mindful of the fact of your habits. I want you to be mindful of your habits as you come to the fork in the road. Metaphorically speaking, we can think about the end of the year as being a junction, as being a juncture, as being a crossroad, a fork in the road, a decision-making moment. The end of the year coincides with the beginning of a new year. It is time when many of us make New Year's resolutions. It is time when many of us decide that we will stop eating a lot of junk food. It is time when many of us aspire to exercise more and lose weight. It is time when we harbor thoughts of adopting healthier lifestyles. It is a time when individuals decide to stop lives of willful sinning and give their lives to God. It is a time when many of us decide to throw out of the window some bad habits and take up some new habits. We have reached the fork in the road. Habits. I heard somebody said once that habit is a strange word. That if you remove the H, you still have a bit. And if you remove the first three letters, H-A-B, you still have it. But all of the things that I've heard about habit, this one is one that I cherish most. And it is sayings from Mark Twain. He says, a habit cannot be tossed out the window. It must be coaxed down the stairs one step at a time. Habit. So as we come to our fork in the road and we think about the habits that we might have entertained throughout this year that is fast coming to an end, I want somebody this evening to be mindful of your habits. Mindful of your habits. When you come to the fork in the road, I want somebody to embrace the fact that you are poised. You are poised for greatness. So you come to this at the end of this year, 2023, and I want to plant in the psyche of somebody here this evening that even as you stand at the end of 2023 and you stand upon the threshold of 2024, that you are poised for greatness. I want you to know, saints of the Almighty God, that when you come to that fork, you must embrace the fact that you are poised for greatness. You must embrace the fact that you are poised to become something great. That you are poised to become something, somebody great. Hallelujah. I once heard my pastor say at a funeral service quite recently, that is, saints of God, that's something to the fact that there are too many unsung heroes lying in our graveyards. That there are too much giftedness and brilliance that has now been buried for too long, comatose in a state of potentiality. There are too many unwritten songs and unwritten poems buried in our graveyards. There are too many potentially life-changing speeches that have been left unsaid, now forever hushed within the confines of our cemeteries. The saying that the richest porch in the world is a graveyard rings quite true. As you come to your fork in the road, know that you are poised for greatness. Say that again, I'm glad that you asked. As you come to your fork in the road, I want you to know that you are poised for greatness. Greatness. Want to pause to ask somebody the question this evening, what is your interpretation of greatness? What does it mean to be great? And please do not tell me this evening that when you are stuck up and when you feel that you are floating on air and you feel that you are God's gift to the human race, that's when you are great. I came across a few characteristics of being great, which I thought I would share with you this evening. Being a great person is about having a continually positive impact on those around you. Being great involves showing kindness and empathy and honesty and integrity, generosity and humility, perseverance and a positive attitude. A great person would always put the deeds of others in front of him. A great person is of selfless character. Greatness is not found in possessions and power, positions or prestige. Greatness is discovered in goodness, in humility, in service, and in character. Greatness is not a fly-by-night thing, but it is something that is continuous. Greatness is wrapped up in the whole aspect of how one lives one life from day to day. Does anybody here this evening know beyond a shadow of a doubt that he or she is great? Amen. Praise the name of the Lord. Yes, greatness is a term used for something or someone beyond the precincts of ordinary. Cyrus, the founder of the first Persian Empire and one of the greatest conquerors of the ancient world, was considered great. Darius, who was king of Persia, was renowned for his administrative genius. He was considered great. Xerxes was the fourth king of the Armenid Empire that ruled from 486 to 465 BC. He was considered great. Garfield Sobers is still considered the greatest all-round cricketer the world has ever seen. He is considered great. The Reverend Lennox Boyce is considered to be a great person, teacher, and preacher. But without a doubt, the greatest human being that ever walked the face of this earth is a man called Jesus Christ. He was great, saints of God. He lived in poverty and was raised in obscurity. He did not travel extensively. Only once did he cross the boundary of the country in which he lived. And that was during his exile in childhood. He possessed neither wealth nor influence, saints of God. His relatives were inconspicuous and had neither training nor formal education. But Jesus Christ in his infancy startled kings. In his childhood he puzzled doctors. In mankind he ruled the course of the world. The names of past and great statesmen of Greece and Rome have come and gone, but the name of Jesus Christ exists and will exist forevermore. Jesus Christ is great and will forever be great. There is no argument this evening that we can bring to disannul the greatness of the Lord Jesus Christ. The angel Gabriel made the pronouncement that he shall be called great. He shall be called the Son of the Highest. That's great. But I want to pause here this evening to reflect on the perception of how Jesus Christ considered greatness. For the Lord Jesus Christ turned the perspective of human greatness in a completely opposite direction to the thinking of the world. Here's how Jesus Christ saw greatness. He says, "Verily I say unto you, except ye be converted and become as little children, ye shall not enter the kingdom of heaven. Whosoever therefore shall humble himself as this little child, the same is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven." Here's how Jesus Christ saw greatness. Whosoever shall receive this little child in my name receiveth me. And whosoever shall receive me receiveth him that sent me. For he that is least among you, the same is great. So when we consider, saints of God, that you, as you stand in the fork in the road, that you are poised for greatness, we must understand this evening that being great is not considered how the world sees greatness. But when you are poised for greatness, it means that your heart must be filled with humility, with selflessness, with love. And as you stand on the fork of this, on the fork in the road right now, and as you think about yourself and consider yourself as being great, I want you to think about being great in the perspective that our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ saw greatness. Hallelujah. Standing at the crossroads. Standing at the fork of the road, greatness. There's a seed that has been planted within you, a seed of greatness. I like the words of Pastor and Minister Peter Balogun, and I want to share it with you this evening. He says, there is a seed that God has put within you when he created you. That seed seed is a seed of greatness. It is a seed of accomplishment. He said, that seed, given the opportunity of expressing itself, enables you to achieve whatever you want to achieve in life. He said that seed that God has placed within you has given you the capacity to become somebody great. So you are poised for greatness. And if you have not, saints of God, grab hold of the fact in this year that is fast coming to a close that God has placed the seed of greatness within you, I want to reiterate the point this evening that you have the seed of greatness within you. And I want to encourage somebody here this evening that all of the shortcomings that might have dogged you during this year 2023, all of the doubts and all of the fears that might have entangled you and have stultified your growth, I want to say to you this evening that as you stand at a crossroad, that you must understand that within you there is a seed of greatness. And I pray this evening that as you step from this old year 2023 into the year 2024, that there would be a transformation, that there would be a metamorphosis, and that you would take up that seed of greatness, and that you would understand that you have been born and brought into this world for something great. The fork in the road gives you the opportunity to change your paradigm. The fork in the road gives you the opportunity to change your ways and to go in a different pathway to which you have been following before. And so if you were contending with mediocrity during this year 2023, I encourage you to shed the cloak of mediocrity and put on professionalism and commitment to the Lord Jesus Christ. Standing at the fork of the road, in the road. This juncture in your life can be a defining moment for you. Approach your fork in the road with positivity and confidence in the God whom you serve. Lay hold, saints of God, of the knowledge that your true worth is a measure of the gifts and talents and potentiality that you possess. I want to say that again because I believe that it is worth saying again. Lay hold of the knowledge that your true worth is a measure of the gifts and talents and potentiality that you possess. So don't let anybody look at you and say what your true worth is from what the outward appearance, but your true worth is what lies within you and what God has revealed within your hearts that He has placed within you. It is neither the total measure of your finances, neither, saints of God, is it the total of your investments, nor your affluence. It is the sum total of the resources that are in you. For you to become distinguished in life, you must grab hold of the realization of the potential that you possess. Fully tap in the bundle of potentiality and expand your capacity for greatness. Somebody said that we have been at the bottom of this mountain for too long. Somebody said, look at this time, God gave me this mountain. And I want to say to us that there might be somebody here this evening who might have been at the bottom of the mountain for too long. There might be somebody here who is saying to God, God, give me this mountain, because the realization has come into that person's psyche that they were born for more. You are standing at the fork of the road this evening, and God is saying, take the right path. I like what Rick Warren has said. He has thrown out the question to the whole wide world, a question that is very useful for each and every one of us to answer. Why are you here? Why am I here? For what purpose have I been born? For what purpose have you been born? I firmly believe that each one of us was born by design and not by happenstance. I firmly believe that not one of us was a mistake, but that Almighty God has a plan for the life of each one of us. It is therefore absolutely necessary for each one of us to fulfill our God-given purpose. I can think about no better time that even as we stand at the crossroads, as we stand in the fork in the road, saints of God, as we approach our fork in the road, when we reach our moment of decision and our moment of decisiveness, I can think of no better time that we reflect on our lives, that we reflect on the gifts that God has given to us, and we say to God, God, if I have not been going in the right direction, point me in that direction. What is your God-given purpose? Listen to the words of the Apostle Paul. It is in Christ that we find out who we are and what we are living for. Long before we first heard of Christ and got our hopes up, God has had his eyes on us. God had designs on us for glorious living, the Apostle Paul says. Part of the overall purpose he is working out in everything and for everyone. So if I had to ask you to share with me what you consider to be the most important day of your life, I wonder what your answer would be. Would it be the day that you found out that you were successful in the common entrance exam and that you had gained a place in the university at Waterford or the university up on the hill at Ashton Hall? Would it be that you would say that it was a day when I said, I will to the love of my life? Would it be, saints of God, that it would be that it was the day that you turned the keys to your own house? Would it be that it was the day that you made your final mortgage payment on your dream house? I wonder, saints of God, what your answer would be. But here's what Mark Twain believes to be the two most important days in one's life. Mark Twain believes that it was the day that you were born and the day that you find out why you were born. He believes that those were the two most important days of your life and will be the two most important days in anybody's life. The day that you were born and the day that you found out that you were born, the reason why you were born. Rick Warren advocates that the only way we will find out the purpose for which we were born is by asking God. For the God who created you is the only one who can tell you for sure the purpose for you being here. So as you come to the fork in the road this evening, and even as you look ahead, I want you to know that you were made by God, you were made for God, and until you understand that, your life will not make any sense. You will just be meandering through life like a ship without a sail. Amen. Hallelujah. Fork in the road. I want to say to us, even as I hurry on this evening, that when you come to the fork in the road, I want you to acknowledge the importance of making the right choice. So first of all, you must understand and embrace the fact that you are poised for greatness. And then you must acknowledge the importance of making the right choice. Life is a journey where the making of choices is inevitable. There's the right and there's the wrong. And we are called in this life to make decisions on a continuous basis. There are times when we make right choices, and there are times when we make wrong choices. It is all part and parcel of life. Making the right choice. The story is told, saints of God, of a journeyman who was undertaking an expedition. He met another traveler and said to the traveler, "There is a fork in the road up ahead. Which way should I go when I get there?" The traveler answered him like this. Keep going straight until you reach the fork in the road. And then when you get there, make the right turn. Keep going until you reach the fork in the road. And when you reach the fork in the road, you must make the right change. I want to suggest to somebody tonight that as you come to your fork in the road, make sure that you make the right turn. Now, you understand that right turn or turning right is relative. So I want to reiterate the fact that when you reach the fork in the road, that you make the right turn. Whenever you come to the fork in the road, always remember that the right turn is the right choice. You must remember Abraham and Lot. You must remember that Abraham gave Lot the choice. And you must remember that Lot pitched his tent on the boundaries of Sodom. You must remember that he pitched his tent where he could look over into Sodom. The Bible tells us that Sodom was a place where men's hearts were wicked. The Bible tells us that Sodom was a place where men practiced wickedness against God. Lot made his choice to pitch his tent overlooking Sodom. I want to challenge somebody this evening that when you are making your choices, even as you stand on the fork of the road, that you make sure that you do not pitch your tent or you do not take up residence near the boundaries of sin. The Bible tells us that we should shun the very appearance of evil. Now, the price that you are liable to pay when you reside near the boundaries of sin is a great price. Make the right choice. For there's a choice you have to make in everything you do. So keep in mind that in the end, the choice that you make makes you. Make the right choice, for choices are the hinges of destiny. Make the right choice, cognizant of the fact that you are free to choose. But the choices which you make today will determine what you have, what you will be, and what you will do in the tomorrows of your life. Saints of God, as you stand this evening at the fork of the road, as you stand at the crossroads, I encourage you to make the right choice. Rather like what Rick Warren has said, he said, changing starts with choosing. Changing starts with choosing. You can choose what you think about. You can choose what you talk about. You can choose what you do. But whatever you do, saints of God, I challenge you to make the right choice. We come closer to the fork in the road. We come closer to the end of 2010 to 23. We come closer to 2024. Will somebody dare to shout like Joshua, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord? Will somebody, as we come closer to the fork in the road, will somebody dare to sing like the songwriter, I've decided to make Jesus my choice? Some folks would have rather houses and land. Some folks choose silver and gold. These things they treasure and forget their soul. I've decided to make Jesus my choice. The road may be rough, the going tough, and the hills are hard to climb. I've started out a long time ago. There's no doubt in my mind, I've decided to make Jesus my choice. Anybody here this evening challenge within their hearts to make Jesus their choice, even as they stand at the fork in the road? Finally, I want to say to us this evening, when you come to the fork in the road, adhere to the necessity of recognizing and obeying the voice of God. When you come to the fork in the road, adhere to the necessity of recognizing and obeying the voice of Almighty God. Of all the things that are important in this life, and the life of the Christian, it is my belief, my firm belief, that hearing the voice of God and recognizing the voice of God, obeying the voice of God, are of the utmost importance. But certainly somebody here this evening will ask the question, how does God speak to me? How can I hear the voice of God? How can I recognize the voice of God? How do I know that God is speaking to me? And these are all legitimate and pertinent questions. God spoke to Moses in an audible manner from the burning bush. Can I expect to have the same burning bush experience that Moses had? The journeying and persecuting Saul clearly heard the voice of God from heaven. Can I expect to have a Damascus Road experience and hearing the audible voice of God? Elijah heard the still small voice of God after the whirlwind and after the earthquake and after the fire. Can I expect to have an Elijah experience? How can I recognize the voice of God? How can I position myself as I stand at the fork of the road to know that God is speaking to me? How can I know that God is directing my path? Will I have that audible God-speaking experience? Isaiah said in Isaiah 13, verse 21, your ears shall hear a word behind you saying, this is the way, walk in it. Whenever you turn to the right hand and whenever you turn to the left, you would hear the voice of God saying, this is the way, walk in it. Isaiah 13, 21 is a verse that it refers metaphorically to the guidance that God provides to those who seek it. Isaiah 30 and verse 21 is a verse that suggests that God can always be depended upon to guide his people in the right direction. Isaiah 30 and verse 21 is a reminder that we should trust in the guidance of God and walk in the ways that he has set before us. Saints of God, isn't it a source of comfort that we as God's people have the assurance that at all of life's intersections, we have God's Word and the Holy Spirit to help us to make the right turns? We might not hear the audible voice of God, but he has given us his Word that is profitable for instruction and direction. We might not hear the audible voice of God, but he has given us the Spirit to guide us into all truth. We might not hear the audible voice of God, but he has given us the signs in our circumstances. We might not hear the audible voice of God, but he has positioned people in the right places and at the right time to give us useful and helpful counsel. God is indeed a good God. Yes, he is. So, saints of God, as you come to your fork in the road, do not hesitate to take the shoes from off your feet, for the place on which you stand is holy ground. As you come to your fork in the road, be confident and say to your God, speak, Lord, for thy servant heareth you. As you come to your fork in the road, do not be afraid to say to your God, what will you have me to do, Lord? As you come to your fork in the road, do not be afraid to sing, I am thine, O Lord. I have heard thy voice, and it told thy love to me. I long to rise in the arms of faith and be closer drawn to thee. As you come to your fork in the road, be not be afraid to sing, draw me nearer, nearer, blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. Draw me nearer, nearer, blessed Lord, to thy precious bleeding side. As you come to your fork in the road, do not be afraid to sing, consecrate me, Lord, to thy service. By the power of grace divine, let my soul look up with a steadfast hope, and my will be lost in thine. You have come to your fork in the road, and there are decisions to make, brothers and sisters in Christ. What decision it will be that you will make this evening. As you have one foot in 2023 and the other foot in 2024, And as you're about to step over the precipice, over the threshold into 2024, I want to encourage you to leave the mundane things behind. And I want to encourage you to reach forth your hand and take the hand of Almighty God. And I want somebody to say, God, I am ready. God, I want you to take me to new heights. I want you to take me, God, Lord, in the way that you want to take me. And I want you to help me to be obedient to your will and to your way. It's a moment of decision. You stand at the crossroad and God is expecting to hear from you. What will your answer be this evening? There might be somebody here who is hearing the voice of God. There might be somebody here who the Spirit of God is speaking, who's tugging at their hearts right now. Somebody who is hearing the voice of God and who is hearing God say, come higher. Might be somebody here this evening who have a desire to be greater than they were before, and greater in the sense that I expostulated earlier in this discourse. You have a choice. And as you stand at the fork in the road, make sure that you make the right choice. Back then, God gave Adam and Eve a choice. They made, in my opinion, the wrong choice. But Jesus Christ came to rectify that. You and I have the ability, because God has given us that ability, to make the right choice for him. Leave the bad habits behind. Grab hold of the good things. Say to God, God, I have full confidence in you because you are my God. You are standing at the fork of the road. It is your moment of decision. It is your moment that you make a decision. I pray that you will make your decision for God. I pray that your decision will be right decision. Is there somebody here this evening? Somebody here who is ready, willing, and able to make that right decision for God? There's somebody here this evening. Your opportunity to do so. Your opportunity to do so. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for the opportunity, God. Thank you, Lord God, for saving and keeping. Thank you for giving us the assurance this evening that you will be with us. For all of those hearts, God, Lord, who are tired, God, Lord, of living defeated lives, and who are saying to you, Lord, take my hand. Take my hand. Father, I am confident that you are reaching out to take those hands. Because you have seen those hands and you are taking them. Thank you, Father, for your goodness. Thank you, God, for your mercy and your compassion. Amen. And amen. Hallelujah.
Praise God. Hallelujah. What a blessed reminder of the fork in the road. As you come to your fork in the road, know that you are poised for greatness and embrace this fact. Showing kindness, humility. In fact, showing the fruits of the Spirit. But it's up to you to decide which path you're going to take. Will you take the one that allows you to fulfill this, or will you take some other path? Keep going until you reach the fork in the road. Make sure, though, that when you get there, you make the right turn. For the choice that you make at the fork in the road will be the making or the unmaking of you. Amen.
Hallelujah.
At this time, we're going to be blessed with a New Year greeting from our pastor, the Reverend Lennox Boyce. We welcome him as he comes.
Praise the name of the Lord. I want to give God thanks that he has brought us to the brink of the year 2024. What a tremendous blessing that we are alive, that we are well, that we are ready to take on a new year. 2023 is in the past. It's in the rearview mirror. But in the windshield is 2024, and I believe that God has bigger things and greater things ahead for us, his people. So I know that as we look back at the year that is gone, there may be some mountaintops that we rejoice for. There may be some valley experiences that made us weep, that made us weak, that caused us stress. But it's all behind us now, and the past is gone, and God has a future for us, his people. I hold on to the word that says, "For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you, to give you a hope and to give you a future." And I believe that God always has something that is good ahead for his people. So I just want to pray that even as we head into this year, that the one thing that we will desire to do above everything else is to hold on to God's hands. Because when we do that, he's going to lead us. He's going to lead us. He is going to guide us. He's going to take us where he wants us to go. So hold on to his hands in this year, so that you go where God wants you to go, so that you do what God wants you to do, and so that you become the person that God wants you to become. May you be blessed beyond measure this year. May the right doors open for you. May God take you higher. May he take you deeper. May he take you further in your faith. And may the Lord bless you and keep you and cause his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. Lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace, both now and forevermore. Amen. Happy New Year and God's blessings from the Silver Sands Church of God.
Happy New Year to you. And before we end, just a few announcements and reminders and upcoming events. The National Church presents Journey to the Throne Room in the Secret Place. It's a time of worship, fellowship, prayer, and release. And this will be taking place on Sunday, January the 7th at the Church of God, Orange Hill, from 5 p.m. to 7 p.m. As well, we have the Princess in Me retreat. The title this year is Called to Shine, Princess in Me Retreat 2024. The venue will also be the Church of God at Orange Hill, and this will take place from January the 19th to the 21st. Now, if you're only going on Saturday, you will be asked to pay $20, but if you're going for the entire weekend, then the fee will be $50. And this is for all young ladies between the ages of 13 and 25. Additionally, we want to remind you that you can join us via social media, follow us on Facebook, or you can subscribe to our YouTube channel at Church of God Silver Sands. You can email us at cogsilversands@gmail.com. Bible study continues every Wednesday night. Right now the topic is Living a Life of Favor. And that happens on Wednesday nights at 7:30 p.m. on YouTube. Men's prayer takes place on Mondays at 5:30 a.m. on Zoom, while women's prayer will take place on Wednesday at 5:30 a.m., also on Zoom. Remember, Sunday school also continues every Sunday directly after church. You're invited to bring the children out to Sunday school. So, it's time to stop allowing those little things in our lives to stop us from achieving excellence, to stop us from achieving greatness. When our Father has proclaimed in His Word that we already have the victory. I know what I'm talking about because I've been there, you see. We must let our lives be filled with new experiences, not only remembrance. So tonight, as we look back to remember where and how far we've come, but we are not staying here. No way. We are going to advance towards the goal. We advance with fight and with purpose. So let us move forward with a resolve to leave behind the mediocrity, but attain excellence in all the things that the Father has said to us this year, that He has said to us this night in reminding us about the fork in the road and choosing the right path. We move forward, not trailing, not frailing, not afraid of failing or falling, but moving on strong, growing in the grace of God. And if it seems that His promises are taking too long to you, remember that God also had given us some flavor for that too. He reminded us that there will always be some difficulty of being between the dream and the destiny. There will be problems, but persistence is the key. God may want us to pledge more, give more of ourselves, and praise Him more, remembering that the giver is more important than the gift. So hence, we must remain strong and faithful to Him. Remember, men of old, as in the Bible it has been told, their promises were not fulfilled in their time, but they held on faithfully, never letting go of the promise, never letting go of the dream. They pressed onward towards their destiny. We must take bold steps this year in 2024. We must step out from our comfort zone and look up and catch a glimpse of where God will take us if we allow Him to. So now it's time to move forward by faith on the platform of God's grace. Things have been put in place. There ain't no more time to waste. To whom much is given, much is required. And that is what God says for us in 2024. I now invite the worship team to come and lead us out.
We only have to live long enough to experience a fork in the road, but may we take Jesus with us. Amen. The great God.